Can start.
Yes. Can we start, sir?
Yes, yes, no problem. You start.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Best of luck to all students.
Sorry, sir?
Best of luck to all students. We can start right now.
Thank you, sir. With the permission of our judges, I would like to start the presentations of today. To begin with, I would request Dr. Kiran Mantri to take over the screen. Sir, please, can you share the screen? Dr. Kiran Mantri, sir.
Yeah, yeah, sure, sure. Please allow me to share the screen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
The time given for the presentation is 6 plus 1 minute. I'll remind once it is 6 minutes, and you'll have to end within a minute. Yes, sir, your screen is open. Yes, sir.
Shall I start? Shall I start, madam?
Yes, sir, you can start. Your time starts now. You can start.
Good noon, everybody. The title of my presentation is "And Preliminary Phytochemical Analysis of Zatifal Kosha, Pericarpa Marishtika Fragrans," under the guidance of Dr. Yogini Kulkarni, Professor, Department of Dravyaguna, PDEA, at College of Ayurveda and Research, Nigri. Contents of my presentation are introduction, materials and methods, observations, result, discussion, conclusion, and references. Coming to introduction, Zatifal Kosha is not mentioned in our Ayurvedic topic. We know Zatifala, we know Zaipatri, but the covering of Zatifala is Pericarp, that is Zatifal Kosha. So background of this study is, no study was conducted on Zatifal Kosha for its phytochemical analysis, and hence the aim of the study was to conduct preliminary phytochemical analysis of Zatifal Kosha. Materials and methods: plant was collected from the herbal garden of Aryavedshala, Kottakkal. The pericarp of nutmeg was cleaned and shade dried at room temperature, and it was made into fine coarse powder. Preliminary phytochemical analysis was performed using various reagents and chemicals, petroleum ether, cyclohexane, etc. And TLC was performed. These are the observation and results. Phytochemical analysis of Marishtika fragrans shows total ash 7.76%, volatile oil is 2%, the fiber content is about 30%, and water soluble extract is 80%. Now, Zatifal Kosha is used in Kerala for as an anti-diabetic drug. They are using as a Heem Kashay. So in phytochemical analysis, we found that it is more water soluble. That shows that Heem Kashay will be more effective. Next, this qualitative analysis of extracts shows presence of tannin, phenol, flavonoids and steroids. The next, there was detection of pectin through the pericarp, and the result was confirmatory. Pectin, as per modern medicines, decreases the absorption of postprandial sugar. Hence, this Zatifala Kosha can be used as an anti-diabetic drug. These are the TLC plates. Discussion. Moisture content was determined to be 11% in dry pericarp, and in the fresh pericarp is it reported as 88%. After shade drying, it can be preserved for a longer duration. Water extract is 80%, which is high, showing the pectin content. Tannin and steroids are also present. So to conclude, qualitative analysis shows the presence of tannin, steroid, flavonoids and phenols. Dried pericarp can be preserved and used for longer time than the fresh pericarp because of former one has less moisture content. These are my references. I thank God, my guru, respected Professor Yogini Kulkarni Madam of Dravyagula, all the teachers of Ayurveda College Akodi, and all the respected delegates. I thank you, George. If there is any question, I welcome any questions. Thank you.
Hello.
Sir, is there any question?
Yeah, I'm Dr. Vivek. Okay, am I audible?
Sir,
yes,
your
sir,
voice
you are
is
audible.
Breaking.
Okay. Tell me the motive about your this subject. Why have you chosen this presentation?
Actually, sir, in Kerala, I had done my MD in Kerala, Kottakkal. There, this Jatiphala Kusha pericarp is used as a folklore practice for diabetes. So for that reason, we have conducted an experimental study. Out of that experimental study, one part of the study was this phytochemical analysis.
Okay. Yeah. No problem. Good.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Vivek Mantri. Thank you, Dr. Kiran Mantri, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
The next presentation would be from Dr. Deepti Ji. Dr. Deepti Ji, you can share your screen. Yes, ma'am, your screen is visible. You can start your presentation. Your screen is visible, ma'am. You can start your presentation.
Screen is visible, so you can start.
Dr. Deepti, your screen is visible. Ma'am, please unmute yourself and speak, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yeah, now we are audible, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am,
you
are audible.
Okay, good afternoon, all of you.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, good afternoon, all of you. I am Dr. Deepti Kadam. I'm working as an assistant professor in VAMT Ayurved Medical College. I'm doing my PhD at APM's Ayurved Mahavidyalaya Sion. The name of my guide is Dr. Ashok Ramtike, sir. Today's presentation topic is critical review of herbs for the management of splenomegaly. As we all know, pleha or spleen is an important organ of our body, which plays multiple roles, which are important for our body. It acts as a blood filter where the RBCs get recycled, and it is a storage for platelets and WBC as well. Spleen has got also a specific immune function, which creates the immunity to toxins and bacteria. According to our Ayurveda, pleha is the moolasthana of raktavaha srotasa as well. What is mean by splenomegaly? Splenomegaly can be defined by the increased splenic dimensions and its volume. If it increases over the 13 centimeter diameter, if its weight weighs above the 400 gram, we can consider it as a splenomegaly. There are various causes of splenomegaly, which are mentioned in our text. It might be because of infective pathology. The most commonest infective pathology is of viral infections. We come to across the splenomegaly in a patients with a viral hepatitis or a viral infections. In most of the inflammatory processes, we can see these pneumomegaly. Then there are various other causes also, like cirrhosis of liver or portal hypertension, or if there is any occlusion in the splenic vein, it leads to the splenomegaly. There are various leukemias also, which in which we can get this splenomegaly. In Ayurveda, we consider splenomegaly as a plihodar. The plihodar and the yakrutodar occur simultaneously. The etiopathogenesis, signs and symptoms, and the treatment also are similar with the yakrutodara, except their anatomical position. There are various causes are mentioned in our Ayurveda text that, regarding plihodara. If someone is traveling in excess, that is means ati pravasa, or someone is doing strenuous exercise, or someone is indulged more into the sexual sex, or someone is walking for the long distance, these are the some causes of plihodara, which we found in our daily practices as well. The symptoms which we get in splenomegaly patient are the patient may complain about the pain and heaviness in their left upper quadrant of abdomen. Splenomegaly might be associated with fever or jaundice. Patient might complain about the feeling of fullness of abdomen. These are the symptoms which we get in plihodara. The commonest symptoms which we found is a varchamutra graha, that means retention of stool and urine. Patient might complain about the parva bedha, pain in their parvas or finger joints. Chardi, the next commonest symptoms is vomiting. Patient might be complained about the mrudu jara or mild fever. Then we go to the signs which we get on the patient. Their spleen becomes so stony, so hard, so that we can feel on palpation, it looks like a back of the tortoise. Then we get to know, we come across the redness or discoloration of abdomen of patient. The etiology, signs, symptoms and treatment, the left arm of that patient. We go to our topic now. I'm going to discuss the herbs which we use to treat the plihodara. Are in our Nigantu, there are various drugs which we use to treat the plihodara, or they are specifically mentioned for the pliha vruddhi or plihodara. The commonly used drug is Rohitaka. It is having Katutikta Rasa, it is having Sheeta Virya according to Bhavaprakasha, or Ushna Virya according to Kayadev Nigantu. It is having Katu Vipaka, it is having Lagu Rukshaguna. For upcoming slide, I am going to show you the their Rasa Virya Vipaka, how they are useful in plihodara. The next drug is Sharapunkha. Sharapunkha is known as a Pliha Shatru. It is having the Tikta Rasa.
Six minutes is over. You have one more minute, ma'am.
Okay, we just go through the names of the herbs. Sharapunkha. The next drug is Eranda, Chitraka, Pipali, Haritaki, Kumari, Swarnakshiri, Mahalunga, Kharjur, Jambu, Daru Haridra, Papaya, Pomifora Myra, Methika, Mahalunga. From the above slides, we can conclude that the most of the dravya which we use for to treat this splenomegaly having Tikta Rasa, they are of Ushna Virya, they are having the Labhu Ruksha and Tikshna Guna. Most dravya do the Vedan Karma. They are used as the Rakta Prasadan dravya. Most of them as like Aranda, Haritaki, as having the Virechana action or a purgative action. They are known for their anti-inflammatory action.
Your time
and lastly,
is over.
They are having they elevate the Vata. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any question? Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Uh, The next presentation is by Dr. Harini.
Okay.
Dr. Harini, ma'am, you can share your screen.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Is the slide visible?
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am.
Good
it's audio. Visible, ma'am.
Yeah.
You can
the
start.
Topic of the presentation is about analytical evaluation of herbs of Hridya Dashamani and in vitro anticoagulant activity of one herb, that is Karamartha, under the guidance of Dr. Lalita Biyar, Professor Hen, Department of Dravyaguna, Government Ayurvedic Medical College, Bangalore, where I am pursuing my PhD. The background behind taking up this study was, we all know that there are 50 Mahakashaya stated in Charaka, Sutra 4th chapter of them, Hridya Mahakashaya is one. Hridya refers to Hridayaya Hitam, which could not only mean about just Manasaha Priya, but probably could have some action on the cardiac diseases. Keeping that in mind, what could be caused or which is a cause for cardiac disorders is coagulation. Hence, an attempt was made to see if any of these herbs have anticoagulative activity so that it can be used as anticoagulant on a regular basis or as prophylactic in cardiac disorders. With this objectives, we have two important objectives to carry out the work. The first one was to evaluate the physicochemical constants of all the 10 herbs of Hridya Mahakashaya, as all of them are not available in the literature. The second objective was to evaluate the anticoagulant activity of one herb, that is Karamartha, botanically identified as Carissa carinthus fruits, at two different doses. One was 250 mg per ml and the other was 500 mg per ml, which was tested with a model called as an in vitro method, plasma recalcification assay. Moving on to the material methods, I have divided into two parts, one with reference to the physicochemical study and other with reference to the in vitro study. In physicochemical study, it was done with collection and preparation of the plant materials, followed by the studies on physicochemical parameters and phytochemical evaluation. So all the 10 herbs of Hridya Mahakashaya, that is Amra, Amrataka, Lakucha, Karamartha, Vrikshamla, Amlavetasa, Kuvala, Badara, Dadima, and Matulunga were collected from their habitat and they were processed by a simple chopping and drying under shade. All these were kept in Ziploc covers and taken for further analysis. The physicochemical analysis, which includes from the standard literature, that is Ayurvedic Pharmacopoeia, which includes foreign matter, loss on drying, total ash, acid insoluble ash, and the extractive values were done in triplicates. And preliminary phytochemical analysis with regards to major phytoconstants, which have been seen in previous literature, were carried out and they're based on standard guidelines. Well, coming to the material methods for the in vitro assay of anticoagulation, the assay was plasma recalcification assay. The plant Karamartha fruits were collected and extracted were prepared. And the second aspect was the collection of the blood samples from healthy volunteers and plasma preparation. And the third is the in vitro assay itself. So the extract was prepared. Here we have taken aqueous extract. Aqueous extract was prepared and two different dilutions were prepared, with this 250 mg per ml and the 500 mg per ml aqueous extracts were prepared. Second is the step is the collection of the blood sample. So we chose it, since it was just a pilot study, the N was 10. We took 10 volunteers whose blood was taken and centrifuged to obtain the plasma. So this was in a saturated plasma as per the anticoagulating coagulation study. We had three groups. One was the blank control, in which plasma was added with calcium chloride to start the recalcification. Similarly, in the other two groups of different concentration, the drug was added along with the plasma and calcium chloride. The time taken to see the coagulation was recorded, and these data were represented as mean per standard deviation. When we move on to the results, again, I have classified under physicochemical study and the in vitro study. So under physicochemical, all the drugs were done with N is equal to 3. They were done in triplicates, and the data you presented here, which includes all the parameters as per Ayurvedic Pharmacopoeia of India. As you can see, there are a few drugs for which API standards are not available, not even from the quality standards of Indian medicinal plants for the fruits of these 10 herbs. Moving on to the results of phytochemical evaluation, we observed that sugars were present in almost all the herbs except Amlavetasa fruits and Karamartha fruits, while proteins were present in all of them. Steroids present only in Vrikshamla, Badara, Matulunga, while tannins was positive for all the fruits of the Hridya Mahakashaya. While alkaloid was present only in Amra, Lakucha, Karamartha, Vrikshamla, Dadima. Moving on to the results of the in vitro anticoagulation activity, it is very clear from the data which I have presented here that the coagulation time for the blank sample was just about 3 minutes, while the samples, plasma samples in which the extracts were added has taken more than 30 minutes, which very clearly shows that there is prolongation in the recalcification time taken to coagulate the plasma. Now moving on to the discussion, with reference to the physicochemical study which has been taken up for the 10 herbs of Mahakashaya, as you can see highlighted in red, there were 3 differences from the standards. That is, one, the alcoholic extractive value of Karamartha and alcoholic extract of Badara. But when we see the triplicates which have been done, as you can see the standard deviation, a few were within the standard limits, but a few, only one sample was not within the standard limits. So very minor change which can be acceptable. Similarly, acid
in 6 minutes over, ma'am, one more minute.
Yeah. Matulunga showed acid insoluble ash, which was more. Moving on to the phytochemical study, the study which we have taken up cooperates with the previous study, but as a part of my PhD study, we have also been trying to search if there is any phytoconstituents which is common in all of these drugs which would be helping cardioprotection. And the plasma recalcification assay which has been taken up is the most convenient and affordable assay for the initial study. And the study shows that it has a good effect, probably due to the phytoconstituents present in Karamartha. And a previous study has shows that p-caumaric acid isolated from Karamartha possesses anticoagulant study. So this, to conclude, physicochemical evaluation gives us the physical constants of all the 10 herbs, and it is addition to the monograph of Amra, Lakucha, Kuvala, which is not present earlier. And the study shows a potential for anticoagulation.
The time is over, ma'am.
Acknowledgements to all the organizers and the colleges. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. The next presentation is by Dr. Vishwatej. Dr. Vishwatej, you can share your screen.
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible. You are audible, sir. You can share your screen. Yes, sir. Your screen is visible.
Is it visible now?
Yes, sir. It is visible. You can start the presentation.
Okay. I will start now. Good afternoon to all respected examiners and faculty members and my colleagues. Myself, Dr. Vishwatej Parakhi. I'm a PhD scholar Department of Dravyagun, Institute of Teaching and Research in Ayurveda. I am presenting my part of research work, that is pharmacognostical evaluation of Spathodia pannulata, who are used as an adulterant of Patala, that is our classical plant, Stereospermum suhabilis, under the valuable guidance of Vaidya Bhupesh Patil, sir. Coming to the introduction, the shmool are the 10 plant roots used extensively for various major diseases like Schwass, Kast, Shoth, etc. Patala, that is Stereospermum suavulens, is one of the content of the shmool which is vulnerable, as according to National Medicinal Plant Board, it comes under the list of 70 high volume traded medicinal plants. Spathodia campanulata is one such species which is found adulterated in market samples of plants. Aim of the present study is to assess and establish pharmacognostical and phytochemical characters in detail for identification of Spathodia campanulata root class. Material and methods, plant collection and authentication. Prior drug Spathodia campanulata roots belonging to family Bignoniaceae was identified by local taxonomies, Dr. Jadeja, on the basis of its morphological characters and with the help of botanical texts and flora growing in Jamnagar suburban areas, external morphology, procured cut pieces of roots of Spathodia campanulata are uniformly cylindrical, elongated, oblong, tapering at distal ends. Most of them are tuberous in appearance and slightly curved. Average length of procured root piece is 45 to 60 cm and average diameter is 2 to 6 cm. External morphology of root bark, key pharmacognostical characters are average length is 15 to 20 cm, average diameter is 0.4 to 0.6 cm in thickness. Color of outer surface is light brown with grayish tinge and inner surface shows white color with yellowish tinge. Touch of outer surface is rough and inner surface is smooth. Color is soily or woody. Taste of the bark is extremely bitter. Fissures are present on the external surface with large horizontal lenticels and fracture is fibrous and irregular. Transverse section of the root bark shows, the diagram section shows the tissues from the cortex with scattered fibers to the phloem region with medullary rays. The detail section shows the multi-layered core and cortex with scattered root fibers and phloem region with alternate bands of phloem fibers and parenchyma with multi-seriated medullary rays. Outer microscopy shows dark brown color with woody odor. Taste also is extremely bitter and touch of the powder is fibrous and smooth. Microscopic characters of the root bark powder shows corking surface view, prismatic crystals, simple and starch green, fragments of fibers and transversely cut core. Preliminary physicochemical analysis shows loss on dry 1.8%, active 2.4%, water soluble extract 15.33, methanol soluble extractive 18.24, and pH found out to be 6.5. Preliminary qualitative analysis found out to be presence of carbohydrates, glycosides, saponins, alkaloids, flavonoids, and tannins, while the proteins, steroids, and amino acids found to be absent. Conclusion, the data specified in the present study regarding external morphology and powder microscopy will help for easy identification of roots and root bark of Spathodia roots belonging to family Bignoniaceae. Physicochemical and qualitative tests will help in establishing standards in identity, degree of purity and quality of the plant material as per pharmacopoeial requirements. I thank you, organizing team Charakamruta, my dean, institutional dean, Dr. Professor R.N. Acharya sir, Preeti Pandya madam, Vaidya Bhupesh Patel sir, and pharmaceutical laboratory giving this opportunity for presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The next presentation is by Dr. Swati.
My screen is visible?
Yes, ma'am, your screen is visible.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon to all respected judges and my Gurujans. Myself, Vaidya Swati Dabi, and I am a lecturer in Dravyagun department, Sri Gulab Kuwarba Ayurved Mahavidyalaya Jamnagar, and I am doing also PhD, first year scholar at IPGT, now ITRA, Jamnagar. This is a part of my PhD thesis work, Ethno-medicinal uses of Pygelia pinnata belonging Bignoniaceae family, a review under the valuable guidance of Vaidya Bhupesh Patel sir. Now come to the introduction. Traditional medicine plays a very significant role in indigenous healthcare systems for humans, and also ethno-medicinal plant use data in many forms has been heavily utilized in the development of formularies and pharmacopoeias and providing a major focus in global healthcare. Why I choose the Pygelia pinnata? Actually, my thesis work is Digellia pinnata used as a substitute of a classical patala, and I found the direct reference from the book Plants of Kutch and Their Utility. The botanist Thakur Jaikrishna Indraji, he claimed that Digellia pinnata is a substitute of patala, and also quoted that it can be used an ingredient in Bruhat Dashmuladikvat, and so the majority descriptive features also matches with the classical patala. Both are from Bignoniaceae family, and also Digellia pinnata in our Gujarat known as a nani padal, and also similarities in both of the flowers. These are the photos, and for ethno medicinal reviews I compiled all the things, all the reported ethno medicinal uses of Digellia pinnata from 5 floras, 8 ethno medicinal books and 28 articles total. And method is I collect all the data and arrange in a tabular form with the different name of Digellia pinnata, and also the part used, and therapeutic indication and mode of administration. And result and discussion included a botanical description of Digellia and also ethno medicinal uses. Digellia pinnata, just a general information first, and it is referred commonly to scientific literature as a Digellia africana, and belongs from the family Bignoniaceae, and only the species of Digellia. And this is the vernacular name and very famous name, Digellia pinnata, known as a sausage tree, is derived from the shape of a fruits, very huge fruit, and shape is like a sausage, so it is called sausage tree, and almost Digellia pinnata known with this name. And also this is the Hindi balam, khira and jadpanus and other names. This is the going to fast morphological character, a evergreen tree with the gray and smooth bark at first peeling on older trees, and also pale brown and yellowish wood. This is the leaves opposite, and also 6 to 10 and oval leaflets, and also the terminal leaflet can be either present or absent. This is the flowers hang down from branches on long flexible stems, and also the bell shaped, orange to reddish or purplish green. This is the fruit, woody berry type and rope like peduncles, and fruit pulp is fibrous and pulpy. And the area of reporting this ethno medicinal claim, ideally the Digellia pinnata also belonging originates from Africa and known as Digellia africana, and naturalized in India and abundantly found in now in India, western and southern India, especially in few species in the Himalayas. And this is the ethno medicinal claims I found in all the articles and books. Total I found 110 internal application and 18 external application with the part used. The root bark is mostly used, and the dosage form is mostly used is as a decoction, and mostly the gynecological complaints and anti and postnatal disorders and conception mostly use the root of Digellia. The root bark also the same, decoction is mostly used as a dosage form, and gynecological complaints and constipation and also tapeworm infection. Stem bark used this 27 diseases, and dosage form also most of the disease used the dosage form is decoction, and the powder is used in infertility and macerated with palm wine with in venereal disease. This is decoction is maybe also useful in wound sore and abscess, and generally venereal disease. And nowadays too many works on Digellia africana or Digellia pinnata in a cancer. The leaves also used as a decoction in diarrhea and dysentery. Also the leaves extract form, and also the ash of a leaves mixed with honey also used in high blood pressure. This is the fruit. Most of the use of Digellia pinnata parts, that is the fruits are mostly used, and too many diseases. Decoction first of all, in major? Also, the Kshir Pak and all the things. This is the external uses, mostly external uses from reduce the blemish-free complexion, dressing the wounds and also rheumatism. This is the children's bath in measles also. This is the seeds. Also seeds paste applied on the affected area of the body to cure fungal infection. This is the internal uses, combination with the some of the part like fruit stem bark and roots, root bark and fruits. This is the external uses and this is the both external and internal. Also Kaigelia pinnata used as a food in traditional life.
Ma'am, your time is over, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. I thank to all the organizing committee and all the my teachers. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The next presentation is by Dr. Ashwini Patil. Dr. Ashwini Patil.
Yeah.
You can share your screen, ma'am.
Okay. A very warm good afternoon to honorable judges, respected staff of JMC Bangalore, the other delegates and PG students. Myself, Dr. Ashwini. Is the slides visible?
Yes.
Not yet.
No problem.
Yes, ma'am. Keep it in high. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Myself, Dr. Ashwini Patil, Assistant Professor, Department of Samhita Siddhanta, Government Ayurvedic College, Mysuru. I am doing my PhD under the guidance of Dr. Srivatsa sir, Professor and HOD, Department of Samhita Siddhanta, JMC, Mysuru. I have taken my PhD dissertation topic, which was done under the guidance of Dr. Jaya Joshi sir from Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, Hubli, and the topic was a study of PCOS on the fundamentals of Trisutra Siddhanta and its management through Narayana Taila Matra Basti. So as the topic was given as recent researches in Ayurveda, so this could be an apt presentation. So Ayurveda stands on its Moola Siddhanta or its fundamental principles, which are relevant till today and will be relevant till it exists. And the Trisutra, the entire Ayurveda is being told in a nutshell in the form of Hetulingaushadha Jnanam Swasthatura Parayanam. So it is including both the preventive aspect as well as the curative aspect. And PCOS was selected. Keeping Trisutra in mind, we can form all the Hetu Linga Aushadha for any of the upcoming newer diseases. So PCOS is also called as a steam Leventhal syndrome, which is one of the most endocrine disorder which has been seen in women of present era. And for any of the menstruation, the important doshik normalizing is the Apana Vayu. Any abnormal activity of the Apana Vayu can be corrected for Vata. Basti is considered to be the best line of treatment. And Narayana Taila mentioned in Sharangadhara Samhita, Madhyamakanda 9th chapter, where he indicates Narayana Taila in Vata Vyadi. But one specific indication was he has given is in the Vandhyatva. And PCOS is one of the common factor for the sub-infertile infertility which we find nowadays. So keeping this in background, this study was taken. These were the objectives: to study in detail the PCOS, to study PCOS with Ayurvedic perspective, Matra Basti, Narayana Taila, and to assess the effect of Narayana Taila on PCOS. So it included both literary study and a clinical trial. Our sample size was only 20 because it was a long duration study of 42 days, 6 consecutive cycles and 7 days after the cessation of menses, and follow up every month, so 6 months, and IPD, OPD of Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya Hubli were taken. So inclusion criteria, group of 20 to 40, and patient presenting with, you have a diagnostic criteria, based on that diagnostic criteria, the inclusion was done. PCOS of both the types were included, lean and the obese, and excluded were those who did not have a disease other than PCOS causing anovulation, tuberculosis, carcinoma, or any of the hyperplasia, Cushing syndromes, HIV, HBS, Ag positive patients were excluded. Based on this diagnostic criteria, the patients were selected. Chronic anovulation, biochemical signs of hyperandrogenism, and polycystic ovaries through the ultrasonography. So what were the parameters of the study? Subjective and objective. Subjective were Going for seeing the regulation of menstrual cycle, changes in acne, hirsutism, obesity and ovulation occurrence. So this was studied. And objective was with the blood investigations, routine investigations and the hormonal assay. So we intervened with the, we observed before and after treatment, the interval between the cycles, how it was, whether it was in the normal or prolonged, whether it came to a normal thing. Amount of bleeding, whether it came to a normal, scanty or spotting, and duration of bleeding in days, whether it was for 1 day, 3 days or it extended up to 7 days. The BMI was noted, the associated features of acne, hirsutism and weight reduction was also analyzed before and after the treatment. And overall assessment criteria was marked here. Disease review was analyzed. Hetu, we have so many classifications of Hetu in general. In specific, if we go for Yoni Vyapad, we have Mithya Ahara, Achara, Daiva and the Bija Dosha. The Lakshana, we have n number of references where we get the Lakshana of Anarthava, Arthava Dushti, we get Ati Pravritti, Vandyatva. All those Lakshanas were analyzed and Aushadha was divided into Samanya and the Vishesha Chikitsa. Observations was done on demographic profile, clinical profile and basis of improvement, and the results were done as marked moderate, and we could found a moderate improvement where the amount of bleeding was improved and mild improvement in 7 patients and marked in the 3 patients. And parameters, overall relief in percentage, amount of bleeding, it was, they went for from scanty during in PCOS, they came to a normal bleeding. Then the interval between the cycles, the acne was improved, the hirsutism has reduced, that we went in the scoring of after how many days they went, the reduction in the threading, what they used to go. So through those all, we assessed these parameters and we could find the result after our treatment. So usually, discussion, we do it on title, literary, on disease, methodology, all together if we do a discussion. Here what we have to do is Trisutra, Hetu, first we have to analyze. Whatever the patient comes, the analyzing of the Hetu is very, very important. Whether that falls in a Mithya Ahara, Mithya Achara, or whether it comes in Bija Dosha or the Daiva. For example, Anarthava, only Anarthava, the Shamanaushadhi can be taken. You have to analyze what is the Hetu over there. If Anarthava along with the Sthaulya, then we have to go for both Shamana and the Shodhana. But if the same as a comes with the, any of the chromosomal abnormalities, like if it is a Shandi, Acharya have told that it is a Anupakrama. So at that time, we don't have any Aushadha option here. So like this, this was the Hetu where we have to analyze based on the present era, like what type of Ahara, Achara they go.
6 minutes, you have one more minute.
The junk food, incompatible food, irregular and inadequate eating. Lakshana in the form of what symptoms they are presenting, whether it is Alpartava, Anarthava, Vandyatva, whether it is a Sthaulya, all these Lakshanas should be done and based on that the Aushadha should be given. So this was my PhD dissertation. At present I am doing PhD on the topic of conceptual and applied study on Indriyasthana of Charaka Samhita on presence of Purusha Ashrita Arishta Lakshanas in terminally ill subjects, and we hope to come out with a very new research in especially in the Indriyasthana done under the guidance of Dr. Srivatsa sir. Center is at JMC Mysore. I thank all the Charakamruta team, DMC Bangalore, for giving me this an opportunity to present my paper. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, good work. You keep it up.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Shall we continue, sir?
Yes.
The next presentation is by Dr. Shashikala Bani. Dr. Shashikala, ma'am, you can share your screen.
Okay. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. You're audible.
Good afternoon, everyone, respected judges, the respected staff member of JAMC and all the delegates. Today, I am myself, Dr. Shashikala Bani, PhD scholars of SDA, prestigious SDM College of Ayurveda, Udupi, under the guidance of Dr. Suma Venkatesh Mallya, presenting in a part and partial presentation, PhD's dissertation work on the experimental study on the hypolipidemic activity of Gozosia abyssinica, Ramtil seed oil, a sustainable traditional oil source. Gozosia abyssinica, Ramtil, Niger seed, is a widely growing plant in the Deccan provinces of India. It's an erect, stout, branched annual herb with an head inflorescence and SNE yielding the seed. Seed, seed oil, leaves are the main useful part. So traditionally, it in locally, it is known as an huchello, gurello, and considered among the one of the use the fruit fruit the edible thing, edible oil, or that is be used traditionally used as an a food article, and the oil is been be considered as an, a sustainable source of an oil. So here, this is an annual plant usually grown in the period of the July to, and the, we get in the yield at the September. So the seeds are being be used to prepare an oil. So objective of this study is to experimentally evaluation of the hypolipidemic activity of an Gozosia abyssinica seed oil on the Vister albino rats. So where the being the oil source, how much it is to be acting as an hypolipidemic is the intention of the study. So null hypothesis has been framed that no changes in the biochemical parameters, and we are evaluating for an alternate hypothesis as an significant changes in the biochemical parameters. So methodology of the study is to collect the sources, collection and preparation of the sample, and the experimental study. So the are collected from the local area around the Gadag districts of Karnataka, and they are properly authenticated, identified, and the quality control study was carried out, and then the oils, the seeds are being be subjected for in a preparation of the oil by the cold compression method. So that then the quality control study of the oil also has been be done by following in all the parameters subjected will be mentioned as an API format. Then the experimental study to evaluate the hypolipidemic activity is been be taken over the albino rats. So inclusion criteria for the hypolipidemic activity is healthy albino rats, not less than of 8 weeks old of an either sex, and the be ranging between the 150 to 200 grams of an weight are being be included, whereas the disease rat and an, those are under the other experiment trial under the other experiments, and the pregnant rats are excluded. So the as the human dose has been be not fixed, that because it is an new contributions to the Ayurveda. So we have taken in a survey to on the human consumption pattern, and the same has been be converted into an animal dosage, and we decided the rat dose as enough 0.43 ml per kg. So then the grouping has been be made within five groups, where the six animals are been be put in each group, the normal positive control as well as standard, and on a single dose of a single dose of a test group, and a double dose of a test group, where the normal control is only receiving in a normal diet and a water, whereas the positive control and other groups are being be receiving in a high fat diet of a cholesterol and a plus and vachaspati, which is about a 40%. So receiving in a 0.5 ml of an per 100 grams of an weight, and the standard one is used as an atorvastatin, and the single dose is of an 0.43 ml per kg of an Gozosia abyssinica seed oil, whereas 0.86 double dose is been be used in a test group second. So here this study has been be simultaneously taken for an 30 days, and the observation has been be made over the ponderal changes and the biochemical parameters, like in a ponderal changes, body weight, weight of the liver, heart, kidneys are been assessed, and the histopathological changes in the liver, kidneys, and the heart are been be taken. Biochemical parameters like in a serum total cholesterol, serum black triglycerides, HDL cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, VLDL, blood urea, blood sugar, serum creatinine, SGOT, SGPT, serum alkaline phosphate, total protein, albumin, globulin, etc. have been be taken. So the data is obtained or analyzed within us using a student t-test and ANOVA test, for F-test followed by the DONET t-test, where the p-value, if it is less than 0.05, has been be considered as an statistically significant, and the percentage decrease in the lipid lowering was calculated using the formula as in the percentile. So observation and result have been made here with an observing after 30 days. So observations of an body weight are being observed here. We are presenting the both the single dose and the double dose are going to be showing in the highly significant reduction in the events. They are not gained much weight as compared to the positive control group. So it is been seen here. In the graphically we can observe here. So the body weight has been reduced much, not as much as this. So serum sugar has been taken as an one of the criteria as the possibility of a diabetic condition after the hyperlipidemic condition. So the diabetic, the sugar level is also observed. So the single dose and the double dose of ANA groups have been not showed in a much increase in the sugar level compared to the normal, but as compared to the positive control group, it is shown in a significant decrease in the both the groups. So we are here, and the lipid profile has been taken. So where the serum cholesterol has been shown in a decrease.
Ma'am, it's 6 minutes. You have 1 more minute.
Significant decrease has been observed with an serum cholesterol and LDL, whereas the other profiles as an liver function does. They are not been taken any kind of changes. SGOT, SGPT, APL, they are not been showing any kind of significant changes. So whereas the weight of the visceral organs have been shown in a significant increase where the it is against the positive control. So here the histopathological changes observed in a liver are having in a mild to moderate degenerative changes in a single, whereas the double dose doesn't have any such conditions. So this is the overall discussion what we are observing. The body weight has been showing in a significant decrease, whereas sugar is also having in a significant decrease. LDL is having in a significant decreases. What we can conclude here is hyperlipidemia is in a characterized by the increased level of a cholesterol in the form of an
lipoprotein,
and thereby we can conclude that the present experiment is been albino rat has been shown that the no significant difference, and the result has been mentioned being the test drug itself, the source of a fatty acid, it is responsible for the decrease of the total cholesterol and LDL, contrary not showed any the significant decrease in the HDL. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. These are the references. I am very much thankful to the organizer for giving an opportunity. Thank you. Thank you, anyone. Just a minute, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
The next presentation is by Dr. Vidya Lakshmi Pujari.
Yes, ma'am. I'm presenting my screen now.
Yes, ma'am.
My screen is visible?
Yes, ma'am, yes. It is visible.
No problem.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dr. Vidya Lakshmi Pujari, working as Associate Professor in Department of Dravyaguna at BLDS AVS Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya Vijaipur. I'm working on a title, Physicochemical and Pharmacological Evaluation of Certain Market Samples of Saliva, with special reference to antioxidant activity by in vitro method. Under the guidance of Dr. Srikant P., Professor Head Department of Dravyaguna, SDMCA Udupi. I took this study entitled with a research question that whether the market samples of saliva matches with the genuinely collected samples of saliva and also matches with the standards mentioned in the pharmacopoeia with its pharmacological evaluation and also for as far as the antioxidant activities. So in this part of study, I'll be presenting the collection of the saliva and also its physiochemical evaluation and antioxidant activities. So in the present study, the four sources of saliva, namely Hemidesmus indicus, Echinocarpus fruticans, Cryptolepis buccinale and Agalepis hamiltoni were collected from its natural habitat in the Western Ghats and the identification of plant was done by the textual references and also with the help of local people around. So during the collection, it was observed that all the four sources of species of saliva has latex present. An appreciable odor of saliva was present in Hemidesmus indicus as well as Decalepis, whether the odor was absent in other two. During the digging, digging process, we could trace the single plant root to some distance. So the hence name Anantamula. So these are the four sources of sariva, the respective roots. The research methodology adopted in this part was organoleptic evaluation, physical evaluation, HPTLC study, antioxidant study by in vitro method by following DPPH and total phenolic content. During the results, observations and results of organoleptic study, we could find that Hemidesmus indicus is thin, coppery red, and odor is present. Echinocarpus comparatively thick, and the odor was absent. Cryptolepis, it was thick, and the odor was absent, and it has got lots of latex present. Decalepis hamiltoni, the roots are very much thick and fleshy, and it has got a very intense odor compared to Hemidesmus indicus. And these are the physical evaluation parameters on loss of drying, acid, total ash, acid insoluble ash, and we could find that almost all matches with the standards mentioned in the pharmacopoeia. And these are the HPTLC study results of all the four sources of sariva, and these are the DPPHSA, results of DPPHSA. In that, we could find that alcoholic extracts of all the four species could showed more antioxidant activity compared to the aqueous extract, and the total phenolic content here also the alcoholic extract of all the four sources of sariva showed higher total phenolic content, and even then in that Echinocarpus showed higher total phenolic content. Discussion part, organoleptic evaluation. In the for organoleptic evaluation in the classical, we find the reference of Shivadatta in Shivakosha Tika. He says that Sariva Dadimi Patra Shweta Rekankita Chada Dugdada Garba Shimbi Fala Tulini Krishna Vallari. So Sariva Dadimi Patra Shweta Rekankita Chada, it exactly matches with the Hemidesmus indicus. Dugdagarbha, all the four species have got Dugdagarbha, that is latex present. Krishna Vallari, Echinocarpus frutescens exactly matches Krishna Vallari as it has got a purplish shade. And coming to the physical evaluation, there is a result of physical evaluation, values of all the samples on parameters like a total ash, acid insoluble, extractive values matches with the standards present in the pharmacopoeia. And HPTLC studies, four samples at various wavelengths shows the brands present. Coming to the antioxidant assay, in the DPPH assay, the standard used was vitamin C. Among all the samples, alcoholic extract shows higher level of antioxidant activity compared to aqueous extracts. And in this assay, Decalepis hamiltoni shows higher antioxidant activity compared to the others. Total phenolic content, in the total phenolic content, gallic acid being the standard, the alcoholic extract of Echinocarpus frutescens has higher total phenolic content. To conclude, the four sources of sariva subjected for organoleptic physical evaluation, all the parameters matches with the standards. As far as the antioxidant activity, DPPHSA shows highest activity with alcoholic extraction, and it shows in the Decalepis hamiltoni, it is a primary type of antioxidant as it donates the iron to free radical and stabilizes it. And the total phenolic assay suggests Echinocarpus frutescens has highest amount of phenolic content present, and as phenols are the secondary antioxidants which stops the generation of free radical. So with this, I conclude my presentation, and these are the references I have referred. Thank you everyone.
Thank you, ma'am. I thank all the presenters for their cooperation.
Thank you.
I call upon Dr. Vivek Gokhale sir to conclude this session.
Yeah, I'm very thankful to all organizers of Charakamrita webinar for giving me this opportunity to work as a judge. And the presentation of all participants and scholars were really good. So it is very difficult for me to give judgment, but anyhow, I will definitely submit my result soon to the organizers. It is a very good webinar which is being held by the government Ayurvedic Medical College Bengaluru, and this type of activity should be proceeded time to time, should be taken time to time. Give my thanks to Dr. Lalita ma'am also, who gave me this opportunity
And is it okay to conclude this session? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I announce that this session is concluded. Thank you to everyone.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for being the judge for us today. The two best presentation would be announced tomorrow after tomorrow's presentation. With this, we come to the end of today's session. Thank you, one and all.